Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. Recently, I have released a couple of videos on the topic of wind turbine blade end of life, looking into the scale of the problem and how it compares to waste from other sources. So currently, the cheapest way to get rid of blades once they're finished on a turbine is to take them to landfill. And that is a huge waste of the material in these blades. So there is a lot of interest in finding better options. One possibility is to cut the blades up and use the pieces to make new products. That's like the ones that Heloisa Lemmertz and her team are working on that I talked about with her in a previous video. But if you can't use the blade pieces in the shapes that they're in, then there aren't really many good options yet. So why not? Why can't we just recycle wind turbine blades as easily as we recycle plastic bottles? There are two main reasons. The first is that wind turbine blades are made of fibreglass, which has two parts. There's glass fibers and they're contained within a resin. The long fibers are what provides most of the stiffness and strength. So if you were to just shred the material and chop up all the fibers really short, then you lose most of the good mechanical properties that the original material had. So to make the most of it, you need a way to recover the fibers and keep them as long as possible. But here we encounter the second problem. You can't just melt the resin out of a wind turbine blade because they use a type of resin that just simply doesn't melt. These are thermoset resins, which is made up of polymers that cross-link when they cure. And when you heat these kinds of resins, the polymers can't untangle again, so they don't melt, they only burn. This is different to other common kinds of plastic that do melt when they're heated. All the plastics that you're used to recycling are thermoplastics. They're also made up of polymers, but they don't cross-link when they cure like thermosets do. They just tangle together. And when they're heated, they can untangle and the plastic melts. In today's video, I'm going to be talking to Ryan Ginder, who came up with a new way to recover the fibers out of thermoset fiberglass and keep the fibers in good enough shape that they can still be used for new structural applications afterwards. I was really excited about the potential, so I got in touch with him to find out more about how the process works and how they're progressing in developing it for commercial use.
Really driving sustainability. The recycling process itself becomes self-sustained. It is economical. It does make financial sense to do this.
Late one Friday, after hours in the lab, I took a couple of milligrams of leftover wind blade material we had from another project trying to recycle them.
Yeah.
Tested it out, and it actually worked pretty well. Process kind of starts right when you're initially taking the wind blade off of the wind turbine. You have this very large structure out in the middle of a field in the middle of nowhere.
Mm-hmm.
So step one is you got to cut it
so that you can efficiently at least put it on a truck and take it somewhere for processing. Mm-hmm. So that's the first step. The next step is we go ahead and further size reduce and shred it down. So after it's shredded, we pack it into our reactor, and that does the reclamation process. The various organic components of the blade, the thermoset polymer, the glues, etc., primarily get removed through heat, but without oxygen, so that the organics get converted into basically a fuel gas of sorts. So we get different petrochemicals coming off.
So until now, the best we could do to recycle composite materials with thermoset resins is a process called pyrolysis, where the resin is heated at a high temperature in an inert atmosphere to recover the fibers. But this typically damages glass fibers, so they end up a lot weaker than they originally were, and then they can only be used for less demanding applications. The resulting material is low value, so commercially, it doesn't really make sense to spend a lot of money to recycle a material just to get a very low value material at the end. Ryan's process works in a similar way to conventional pyrolysis, but without causing as much damage to the fibers, so you end up with a higher value material at the end. And the resin that's removed is used as an energy source to power the whole thing. Ryan will explain how it works in a bit more detail.
Some of the petrochemicals that come off, those are cycled back into the process to maintain the temperature. So the recycling process itself becomes self-sustaining. The energy obtained from the polymer components provides the energy needed to recycle. As it comes out the back end of the setup, then we then have our ultra clean surfaced, relatively mechanically intact glass fiber.
So you can make like a chop strand mat from it.
Correct. So we're looking at a couple of different routes for it. With the longer fiber, as you said, we can do different types of non-woven fabrics. Mm-hmm. Those can either be pure glass fiber, so you can do resin infusion methods used by things like the marine industry for making boats, mm. or you can feed those into what are sheet molding compound processes. Mm. Those are used by things like the automotive industry for dashboards, truck beds, etc. So there's a couple of different technologies we're pursuing.
Yes, and next I wanted to ask you about the time frames. You're working on a pilot demonstration at the moment. What sort of size will that be? What sort of volumes can you process? Where are you going and how long will it take you to get there?
The pilot line itself won't be fully commissioned until the first quarter of 2021. It was designed to be readily scalable. So we expect you 1 to 2 plants would be enough to meet the U.S.'s existing wind turbine blade disposal needs as well as its projected immediate future needs, and that could break ground by 2022.
Okay. Wow, that's faster than I was expecting. I was expecting maybe a decade to reach that. So that's exciting.
It's interesting. We are moving a lot faster than I thought. But on the flip side, we're actually still getting told by various people we meet with, we need to move faster.
Yeah, well, of course, everyone always wants the solution yesterday. No one wants to wait. Mm-hmm. So you started with milligrams, then you went up to a blade tip, then now you're on to whole blades, all within, a couple of years?
Yep. So we went from milligrams to kilograms, now to metric tons. It's gone fairly well.
I think that is really fast for a technology scale up from lab scale to pilot plant in such a short time. And then only another couple of years potentially until it's at full commercial scale. So far, this all sounds good, really good. Is it maybe too good? It occurred to me that wind turbine blades from different manufacturers don't all use exactly the same materials. Even if they're all using a lot of fiberglass, different manufacturers use different resins, for example. Some using epoxy, others using polyester resins. Not to mention other fiberglass products like boats and car parts. Will the plants be flexible enough to process all kinds of fiberglass products, or will we need like a separate factory for every single product and every single manufacturer?
The process is material agnostic. Okay. So I can throw in wind turbine blades, I can throw in truck beds, I can throw in basically any sort of polymer composite into the process. So where the limitations will come in are, for example, in the case of wind blades, right, the starting composite is a continuous fiber composite. And in order to process it, we shred it into discontinuous fiber. So obviously it can't be immediately reused for the exact original application in that case.
Okay, and so of all the glass that goes in, how much glass comes out? Do you lose a lot along the way?
Nothing's 100% yield, right? But it's definitely in the 90 to 100% range as far as we can tell so far.
Wow, okay.
You don't really lose anything.
So that sounds really good. And then, of course, so if you're using the resin as a fuel, I mean, that's a fossil fuel effectively, right? You're going to be creating emissions burning that.
Yeah, so there are emissions associated with obviously burning the resulting syngas that comes off. We are collecting the data and stuff. But what I can talk about is the very related process of conventional pyrolysis. And what they found in that was that the actual CO2 emissions tied to processing the scrap in this manner was like 1 to 2% of the total emissions of the lifetime of that blade.
Oh,
so
okay.
Very minuscule portion.
One thing that's really interesting to me about this whole issue is that I think the focus on wind turbine blade waste is a bit out of proportion to waste from other sources. That is the other aspect of Ryan's process that I think is really cool. It's not just for wind turbine blades, which make up only 5% of products made out of composite materials. This process could be used to recycle the other 95% too, so it has the potential to make a big impact.
That's one of the things I've enjoyed working with wind, is the fact that it actually is economical. It does make financial sense to do this. This is a sort of shift in the U.S. that has kind of happened, I'd say, within roughly just the last 5 or so years towards really driving sustainability. If you would talk to people in, say, 2010 about this kind of thing, nobody would have even paid attention to you. Now the industry is climbing over itself to move in this direction.
That was such an interesting conversation for me. Ryan and his team have taken the challenging problem of recycling fiberglass and developed a solution that looks really promising in terms of the practical outcomes and the economics too. Obviously, there are already a huge quantity of wind farms whose blades are made using these thermoset resins. So we're going to need processes like Ryan's to recycle all the existing blades that are going to need to be recycled over the coming few decades. But what about future blades? Can we change their materials to make them easier to recycle? Actually, there are quite a few wind turbine manufacturers working hard on projects like this, looking into new materials for wind turbine blades that are still strong and stiff enough to function correctly as a wind turbine blade, but also easy to recycle. If that sounds interesting to you, then let me know in the comments, and I will do some more videos on that topic. Please let me know in the comments if there was anything in today's video that you want me to explain in more depth, or if there's another topic that you would like to see me cover. Please remember to like and subscribe and share with your friends, and I'll see you next time.